So what exactly makes a good, authentic shirt? That's what we're talking about on this week on the 11th OVC. Thanks for watching. Welcome again to another edition of the 11th OVC. As we continue to plow through the basic uniform of the Federal Cavalry Trooper during the American Civil War, our next topic will be to cover the basics on what type of shirt you'll be looking for your impression. The shirt is one of those fundamental things, again, on what can set you apart from reenactors as far as what can make you look very authentic or what can make you look very Farby. So let's talk about shirts. The man's shirt during the American Civil War was still considered underwear as a basis for cultural understanding. It was made to be worn under clothing and not exposed to the public. This has been an ongoing discussion among many reenactors since the beginning of reenacting, but the best way that I can put it is by reading a diary entry from a working cowpuncher in 1879. Yes, I understand this is 14 years past the Civil War, but I still think it actually holds more credence to what they thought of shirts back then. His diary said, "I had a new white Stetson hat that I paid $10 for and new pants that cost $12 and a good shirt and fancy boots. They had colored tops, red and blue with half moon and star on them. Lord, I was proud of these clothes. They were the kinds of clothes that top hands wore. And I thought I was dressed right for the first time in my life. I believe one reason I went home was just so I could show them off. When I got there, my sister saw me and said, 'Take your pants out of your boots and put your coat on. You look like an outlaw.'" While this diary entry definitely needs to be taken in context, being a cowpuncher in the 70s, its insight, which is, you know, again, 14 years or so after the Civil War, still shows that the expectation of gentlemen was to cover their shirts with their coats. However, it must be recognized that, just like today, it was the expected of gentlemen, which didn't really mean that everyone did it or that it was the norm. It'd be safe to say that the working blue-collar men frequently showed their shirts through vests or with no covering at all. But with all that being in context, the argument of, you know, is it like showing your underwear today or anything like that? In a way, yes, but also in a way, no. It's right there kind of in the middle, which when you are operating the field, when you are in campaign, in camp mode, at garrison, or when you're in front of gentlemen or other ladies, is something to keep in mind. You know, again, not the be-all, end-all rule of thumb, but something to just keep in mind in the context of your impression. So let's talk about the differences in the different patterns of period shirts. From the Revolutionary War all the way up to the 1850s, shirts can be characterized by square cut pieces that were easy for family and women and even the men to sew, however had little fitting. Starting in the 1850s and progressively getting more common, men's shirts lost the overly square pattern and became more fitted and more tailored to the different men, different sizes that were out there. One thing to note also, as far as the buttons going down the front, a second major change that came to men's shirts was to have the buttons go all the way down the front versus have to slip it over your heads and then just have a couple buttons as you see here on my shirt today. That did not get adopted by the military until 1941. So as just a quick disclaimer right off the bat of this episode, just know that if you have a shirt buttoning all the way down the front, that is definitely pretty Farby unless you have good documentation for it. However, as we filter everything through in our reenacting hobby, it was not normal, not usual, not general, therefore not NUG, even if you have documentation to have a full frontal down blouse. So for those of you who have shirts that button all the way down the front versus have to slip your head through it, keep that in mind in the context of your impression. So, therefore, examining men's shirts before 1900 revolves around the square cut and fitted shirts that you have to kind of slip into versus button all the way down the front. Having a shirt that buttons all the way down, again, is pretty Farby. So when it comes to shirts, the question you need to ask yourself is whether to go with issue or non-issue. That's when it comes to the American Civil War reenacting hobby, that's the two major options. Do you want to go with the issue shirt or the non-issue shirt? So with this context, if there's any museum quality reproduction out there to get used to, it is definitely the military issue shirt, the flannel shirt. Again, I've said this in previous episodes, but the wool flannel that we'll talk about for the issue shirts definitely is not the most comfortable material to get used to, but it is NUG for sure. So to help dispel some of the myths or the doubts that still exist about this subject, we'll give you some, I guess, of our reasoning for the so quote-unquote justification of the issue shirts only rule that we have for certain events that we go to. The first oft-quoted account by Gettysburg burial details, even after fighting the battle in the middle of the summer, the Union dead could be distinguished by their shirts as described by the following quote. Quote, "The underclothing was the first part examined. The rebel cotton undershirt gave proof of the army in which he belonged." Again, based on this point in the war, the time of the year, and the context this quote was from, this single quote lends some significant weight, and simply put, Federals were in the issue wool flannel. Again, whether it be the white flannel or the gray flannel, they were in the issue flannel. And that was in July of 1863. Clothing records can provide more evidence, and statistical study was done by a well-known reenacting group that gave this information. And it's out there. It's on the Authentic Campaigner. It's on a few other websites if you want to get this information. So this unit did research, and out of their findings, which is actually they studied Company F of the 33rd Massachusetts Infantry, all of the quartermaster returns of all the clothing issued to the members of the company were gathered. In a one-year period from November of 1863 to October of 1864, which, keep in mind, includes the Atlanta campaign, so they found that the study of that Company F, all said and gathered, when you take out the KIAs, when you take out men on detail, there were 21 men left in that company, that's range, that were in that company the entire year. So that study was left with those 21 men who served with the company for the entire period. And here's what the information of this study produced. Number one, the average number of flannel shirts drawn per man for that period was 2.5 shirts per man. Number two, of the entire group of 21 men, only 3 men did not draw shirts in the period before the advance on Atlanta. So most drew one, and some even drew 2 shirts during that time frame. Every man was drawing issue shirts by the time the regiment was resupplied in July of 1864, including the 3 who probably started off with civilian shirts, who at the time did not get issued the standard issue shirt. So to put it in reenactor terms, about 1 out of every 7 of these soldiers started the Atlanta campaign with either no shirt at all, which is highly unlikely, really worn out issue shirts, which is possible, or shirts procured from other sources like sutlers or even from home, which of course is most likely. By July of 1864, after at least 2 full months of active campaigning, now even these men who had non-issue shirts were being issued shirts by the end of that campaign. The study examined the possibility of soldiers drawing shirts but not actually wearing them, as that is possible. Perhaps they sold them, traded them, or sent them home, but not only did they fail to find any period correspondence to support this, they actually found out that, again, like today in a lot of contexts, it is illegal for soldiers to sell or otherwise market or benefit from military clothing and equipment. Another possibility is that some of these soldiers had more than one shirt, and their other shirt was a civilian model. But since there are numerous references to troops on campaign being destitute of spare underclothing of any kind, the statistical impact of this possibility was determined as slight or negligent, really. Needless to say, all of this has led to the conclusion that soldiers on campaign were normally wearing those issue shirts. Some Union soldiers wore shirts that were issued from sources other than the federal government. There were state-issued, community furnished shirts of various kinds and colors. Most of these did not obviously last long enough to in the field to be really seriously affecting the what we call NUG as reenactors, or the overall look of the armies. But it is something that you need to know, depending on if you come from Ohio, Pennsylvania, New York, in those early wars of the year or early years of the war, it is something to take into context with those homegrown or home designed shirts. Other soldiers did wear shirts bought from Sutler Row, sent home or procured in other ways. But I guess the whole point that we're trying to get an idea of is, what was NUG? Exactly, you know, if we want to be a NUG soldier out there on campaign, in the field, fighting the fight, were they wearing issue shirts? Were they wearing civilian, shirts from home, shirts from Sutler Row? What were they wearing? And with the study and the context done, you can't argue that the NUG soldier was wearing the issue flannel shirt. So now the question is, what kind of issue shirt? Now that we have established the foundation that the best shirt is an issue shirt, we must now decide which issue shirt. Because of course, there was more than one type of issue shirt. So what kind of issue shirt is best for your impression? So in a study of the shirt contracts that differentiated between materials being used, the breakdown between the combined purchasing records of the New York and Philadelphia depots was the following. Knit shirts constituted 46% of the standard issued shirts to the Army. Gray flannel shirts constituted about 14% of the total issued shirts in the Army. And these white flannel shirts made up 40% of the standard issue shirt to the armies. This excludes the shirts actually made by the Schuylkill system and more concentrate on the contracts that were let. However, in Cincinnati alone, gray flannel shirts like I'm wearing right here accounted for 80% of the issue shirts purchased for distribution. Again, that was at the Cincinnati depot, which is something to keep in mind for you Western reenactors. Since we currently have an imperfect knowledge of what the knit shirts actually look like, they seem to be, you know, obviously a more difficult product to research, a difficult product to purchase and to find. If you are interested in the knit shirts, obviously because they did account for a good portion of the issue shirts out there, I strongly recommend going to Nick Sakala. Again, good products out there. Obviously, he's not the only one. So you YouTube guys out there, don't ream me for just pulling out his name. He's the one I go to for a lot of my quality products, but there are others out there. If you want a knit shirt, that's where I recommend starting. But even after, adding estimated production figures from Schuylkill and then all the other contractors in there, again, the best shirt to have as a reenactor would have been the white flannel shirt, the white flannel issue shirt like this. This is the gray flannel. This is the white flannel. Both of which are not the best or the easiest to wear, but they are NUG. So when talking about the dominant flannel issue shirts, whether we're talking the gray issue flannel or the white issue flannel, there are very few positive comments made by the soldiers on these dominant flannel shirts. Here's a good example from the feelings of a soldier toward his government issue shirt. Quote, "The shirt was, well, a revelation to the most of us, both as to size and shape and material. It was so rough that no living mortal probably could wear it, except perhaps one who wished to do penance by wearing a hair shirt. As tough as these veterans were, their skins appear to have been just about as sensitive to dominant as ours are today. The blessed original dominant flannel shirt resides in a collection of Don Troiani. Don't know if I pronounced that right, but I'm a reader, not a pronunciation-er, obviously. So it is very high. Is a very light cream color and is of plain weave, also called tabby weave, with approximately 46 cotton warp threads per inch and 36 wool weft threads per inch. Compare this with the government specifications for dominant, and you will see that the weft count of 36 falls significantly short of the specifications called for 56. Not 36, but the government called for 56. Scattered throughout the fabric are bits of bark material and bits of plant husk, which obviously is definitely a second-rate flannel at best. It is obvious that the shirts are hastily assembled and hastily made. Their hand sewing varies from 4 to 6 running stitches per inch, back stitches, whip stitches, all sort, and it's not consistent at all. A poorly fitted shirt back and collar cause a humpback appearance over the nape of the neck. The buttons are 1.2 inches in diameter, 10 sheet iron, four holes with 10 backs. Now, overall, the shirt in this collection appears to be quite shoddy, again, at best. No wonder the soldiers weren't even impressed with them if they're having bark residue rub up against their skin. So even if it was the white flannel shirts or the gray flannel shirts, either way, they definitely weren't very comfortable. So now let's talk about sizing of the shirts, especially these issue shirts. When it came to sizing the troops, the government intended the shirts to fit most, if not all, of their soldiers. However, many subscribe to the myth that this, as well as other issue shirts, were made only in one size. The basis of this assumption has been the yet unpublished Quartermaster's Manual, which gave rudimentary sizing in addition to complete bill of materials. Subsequent documentation, however, clearly shows the shirt was made and issued in at least three different sizes. As far as the knit shirts, I have some, I guess, closing or final thoughts on these knit shirts, as, you know, they did constitute, you know, a good majority of the shirts out there. As we stated earlier, there are no known survivors, or maybe I should show my ignorance. I know of no known surviving knit shirts, and although the variety surely existed since it accounted for 46% of the contracted shirts in the East, it is hard, again, to find a detailed photograph showing the soldiers attired in these knit shirts. This situation is unfortunate considering the large quantity of this style that was issued to the Army of the Potomac. In fact, the knit shirts were one of those items that were most unique to the Army of the Potomac, since they were most solely the output of the two eastern depots. Since Cincinnati accounted for only a little more than 3% of the knit shirts came out of Cincinnati, which means most of those, the 46% of knit shirts that accounted for all of the armies as a whole, the vast majority of those went to east. So the Army of the Potomac, in that middle main part of the war, really constituted most of the knit shirt population, which is interesting for you Eastern reenactors. Three machines were needed for the production of a knit shirt and ribbed cuff or tip machine for knitting the wristbands, a sleeve machine, and the shirt machine that knitted the material for the shirt body was obviously complex and not rudimentary, but complex and expensive. And you could argue that that's why, you know, part of the reason why knit shirts are kind of in its own category all by itself. And of course, as we all know, knit shirts don't really stand up to hard campaigning. Last thought on knit shirts, although most of the knit shirts were probably collarless, the government did release at least one contract for knit shirts with collars to a New York City firm in September of 1862. So there are some, or were some, collared knit shirts out there. So now let's shed the issue shirts for civilian shirts. So some soldiers did procure non-issue shirts, and we can find documentation of this if we look hard enough. Now keep in mind, civilian shirts that most reenactors wear actually were not NUG. Again, going back to the standard issue dominant flannel, those were NUG. So civilian shirts actually would be considered rare, if you will. A soldier from the 150th New York wrote at the beginning of 1863, he wrote, quote, "If you have the opportunity to send me four woolen shirts, two of fine, white, thin, woven texture for undershirts, the other two of flannel plaid, a very light color, not red if avoidable, and will not fade, this will constitute my summer arrangement." End quote. So this particular soldier probably had trouble fitting into the issue shirt, as he was 6'2", as we know from previous records. The other soldiers wrote home preferring red flannel, as this color was actually thought to promote good health. Another man, this one a brand new member of the 116th Pennsylvania, wore his civilian shirts into the spring campaigns of 1864. Unhappy with the government issue, he requested shirts from home, which he received on April 8, 1864. On June 8th, he wrote that he still had them, but they were quite dirty. Another man, this one a member of the 12th Corps, recorded a price he had paid a sutler for a shirt in August of 1863. Quote, "Bought a checkered shirt for $2. Our sutler came up last night and sold out." Unquote. This last quote provides another reason why soldiers may have preferred to draw army shirts. Whereas this settler shirt cost $2, an army shirt cost a soldier $1.40 from his clothing allowance. So when you're purchasing a civilian shirt, some discretion should be used before procuring or getting a civilian shirt for the reason that we just discussed as far as it not being NUG. So the question remains, is a civilian shirt correct at all based on your impression? Are you portraying a soldier just out of winter quarters? Are you a new recruit? Are you portraying a soldier who has just come from garrison duty somewhere? If so, you probably shouldn't consider a civvy shirt unless one or more of these conditions are true. Again, if you are portraying a soldier out of winter quarters, civvy shirts are a little bit more common. A new recruit, again, civvy shirts are okay, more common. Are you just coming from a garrison somewhere? Again, civvy shirts are more common. But one thing that became obvious and true throughout the Eastern and Western theaters is that soldiers that were on campaign, hard fighting, hard moving, and fighting, they wore out of their civvy shirts pretty quick and transferred to their standard issue shirts soon after. So again, you know, as with all of reenacting, what impression you're trying to portray really is what your answer to whether you do standard issue or civvy shirt like what this is. So if you do choose a civilian shirt, as apparently 90% of the reenacting hobby has, make sure you choose the correct one or the right kind. Shirt styles were changing in the mid-19th century, and photographic evidence suggests that a number of shirts in northern regiments could include a percentage of both older and newer styles. If you remember us talking, the square cut pattern was from, you know, all the way from the Rev War all the way up to the 1850s, and then the new kind of fitted, kind of little bit more tailor-made shirts started in the 1850s, 1860s on. So keep that in mind as well. So let's talk about the early square cut shirts. The shirt that was prevalent in the early 1800s followed a design that remained basically unchanged for several hundred years. By the 1860s, the primary source for shirts were, again, the home seamstress who hadn't switched over to the more modern styles since the ready-made shirt industry was already switching over to the modern, more fitted shirt style that we'll discuss next. Square cut shirts were made of linen, wool, cotton, or a combination of these. The last of the square cut shirt holdout styles were seen from the mid-1850s and generally fade out by the mid-1870s. The US government showed that about 11 million shirts were contracted out during the war, yet less than 11 are known to survive today. This confirms a rule of thumb that the military tends to be about two decades behind the modern fashion trends of the period. So now let's talk about the more modern, if you will, fitted shirt styles. So with this new arrival and this new standard fitted shirt, it actually originated from France in about the 1850s, with the primary difference being that the sleeves were now set into the shirt body and some other variations that made the shirt fit to the soldier rather than just being completely square cut. In this picture, you can see how the sleeves are actually sewn into the fit of the body of the shirt rather than how the sleeves are sewn in the square cut version that we previously talked about that you can see in this picture. The first fitted version was still a blend of new pattern with holdover traits from the square cut shirts. For instance, the bottom is still square. In this one example, the collar is two pieces, which also helps it stand up, and the shirt is made of cotton. In this other example, actually taken off the Steamboat Bertrand, the shirt is actually made of cotton with a narrow 1 1/4 collar. Also, note the rounded bottom of the shirt. And the shirt is also made of a pattern that is about 1 1/4 inch square pattern. Now notice that even this later style shirt still has a pullover design to it and does not, keyword not, button all the way down the front. This last shirt is interesting because no two buttons are alike. While it is hard to see in these pictures, of course, it is interesting to know that this is a fun way to customize your shirts while still being decently authentic. You know, you could have a variety of buttons being replaced one at a time as they fall off during campaign, hard use, or anything like that. The shirt also has a 7/8 collar and is lined on the inside. Also note the rounded shirt bottom. Finally, it is also important to note that the shirt has a cotton and linen construction, with linen being in the front of the shirt and the other obviously on the back of the shirt, which is, you know, kind of unique as melding two different fabrics in one shirt. So let's sum all of this up. So after all that information, let's filter our decisions through kind of one major conclusion. And again, we filter everything through the acronym NUG. What was normal, what was usual, and what was general. Again, 46% of the shirt contracts were knit. 40% of the shirt contracts were white flannel, and 14% were gray flannel. So technically, to be continually NUG, the shirt that you need is a knit shirt. Obviously, again, that's kind of overgeneralizing. That's more Army of the Potomac, whereas if you were in the Western theater, the gray issue flannel shirt may be more NUG. But again, I like to overgeneralize, okay, to make things really inauthentic, right? But since knit shirts are hard to come by, I mean, Nick Sakala makes a good pair, and I'm sure there's others out there. If anyone wants to make a comment below in the notes section, feel free, as you know, this the hobby of reenacting is pretty much a underground hobby of people making things and not everyone knowing who's out there that makes quality reproductions. So other than Nick, you know, feel free to comment down below. Either way, there are a lot of good manufacturers out there. But knit shirts, all said and done, are hard to find in addition to knit drawers that we talked about in our drawers episode. So, however, due to the rarity and expense of these knit shirts, most of us go for other shirts. Unfortunately, in the reenacting hobby, most have gone with the civilian style shirts because they're way more comfortable, cooler generally, and just cooler looking, maybe. So, but again, to be NUG, we should go with the white flannel or the gray flannel issue shirts. So, we have to address the bleach white, extremely gaudy, off-white, sutler row muslin shirt that most vendors, most sutlers, and most reenactors actually have. In fact, if you'll see in previous videos, I definitely sport the bleach white or the off-white sutler row type shirt. These shirts obviously were not made authentically. They are not made of shirting material. Shirting material is a lot denser, a lot tighter weave, a lot more durable than the standard Settler Row quality shirts that they sell today. The muslin found in Settler Row quality shirts, again, not generally used for the heavy use that shirts would see, especially in military use. It was used, muslin that you see the reenactors wear or that the standard Settler Row quality shirts have, that type of muslin was generally seen for underclothing that would not be used for heavy use as seen on military campaigning. So you chose to get a shirt. So let's talk about the shirts and where we can actually get them. Now, please keep in mind that I'm not covering all the vendors of the quality shirts out there. And, you know, as soon as I post this, it'll be outdated because of all the people in the hobby that start creating their own fabrics, their own general goods. In fact, the best quality shirts are by little known individuals who I don't know and a lot of people don't know, but they're out there in the hobby. Try to find those guys. A lot of those produce really good quality stuff. Now, that being said, I personally like the gray flannel shirts made from Wambon White. They're good quality shirts, good stuff there. Like the original Soldiers Complained, I have a hard time wearing this as it is pretty itchy against my really sensitive, delicate skin. Wambon White also makes great civilian shirts. You can see, you know, this shirt right here. You can get any of their clothing in kits that you can make and sew yourself, which gives you a good quality fabric, a good quality shirt for a kind of a Settler Row price, as long as you're willing to do the work yourself. And of course, as we mentioned before, another vendor out there that makes awesome quality shirts is Nick Sakala. We've mentioned him before. His shirts are awesome. At least the ones I've gotten are awesome. They're generally around $150, $160, and from what I've found, extremely well worth it as far as the quality, the marks on the military goods. I mean, very, very well put together. You will wait a little time, but as long as he's up front with you, he'll let you know. Of course, the Regimental Quartermaster sells some quality shirts and kits, both from Wambon White and Nick Sekela. But again, I don't want this to be a, he's better than her or her. He's better than that guy or that guy's better than this guy. And there's a lot of manufacturers, a lot of vendors out there. And this is not a contest. Okay. This is a hobby. And I just want to help some of these new guys find some of these places, because it took me a while to find Nick. It took me a while to find Wamba. Honestly, when you first get in the hobby, whether it's the search engine optimization or SEOs of the other settlers out there, you know, Fall Creek and the what I call the Walmart vendors, they're awesome. They cover 80% of the reenactors out there. But for some of you guys who are looking for a little bit more quality that can hold up to true hard campaigning, there's other vendors out there. So if you guys have any other comments or questions, feel free to write them below, and we can kind of spout out some of those homegrown vendors that make good quality reproductions, as there are hundreds of good quality manufacturers out there that are little known to our hobby. All right, well, that was the basics of what to look for in choosing what shirt to wear for your reenactments. Again, we need to filter our impression for what would have been the norm, what have been the average shirt that the standard trooper would wear. And again, that determines, I mean, that's based on, are you campaigning? Are you in garrison? Or are you a new recruit? Using the criteria of NUG, you may get away with civilian and other unique shirts in early war impressions. However, whether your impression was Army of the Potomac or the Western Armies, even after one hard campaign season, records make it clear that after one hard campaigning season, most, if not all, the troopers, obviously not all, but most of the troopers would have had the standard issue shirt. So in order of priority, that would have been a knit shirt, number one, a white dommet flannel issue shirt, number two, or the gray flannel shirt, again, in that priority. And of course, if you choose to wear a civilian shirt, which again was not NUG, please avoid the bleach white, off-white, Sutler Row muslin type shirts. They're generally made with the wrong material, constructed improperly, sits wrong on you, and you want to get a quality print shirt that conforms to the civilian patterns that we have previously discussed. So we hope you've enjoyed this episode. It's beneficial for your impression. Please show help by supporting this YouTube channel by hitting subscribe or like. Please like us on Facebook, and stay tuned for another episode of the 11th Ohio Volunteer Cavalry.
We're the 11th Ohio Volunteer Cavalry. You'll see us on our horses riding fast and fleet. We keep history alive by showing you how it was done. The truth about how the West was won.